don't have much to breathe. My heart is torn in pieces. It's my offering. Take me to the King. Truth is I'm tired. Options are few. I'm trying to pray, but where are you? I'm all churched out, hurt and abused. I can't think what's left. Truth is I'm weak, with no strength to fight, no tears to cry. Even if I try, but still my soul refuses to die. One touch, it will change my life. Take me to the King. I don't have much to breathe. My heart is to stop playing these games. We need a word for the people's pain. So Lord, speak right now. Let it pour like rain. Yeah. We're desperate. We're changed. Oh, no rules, no religion.
the Lord. Seated on the throne, and he's clothed in glory. And exalted high, and the train of his robe, it filled the temple, and the angels sat around and cry,
"You are holy, oh, so holy. You are holy."
Have seen the Holy King, and he cleansed my lips right before my eyes, and the
Mercy seat. is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is He.
Listen, church.
Sing a new song to Him who sits on heaven's mercy seat.
Stand with me this morning. Stand, grab your Bibles, turn the book of Acts. Acts chapter 27. Amen. I don't know if I'll be long, but I won't be slow. Amen. You pray for us. Acts 27, we're going to begin reading here in verse number 14. Oftentimes I pray and wonder, lean to God in the Spirit, if I've got the right message this morning. I think God's done give me the message. Look here at verse number 14, chapter 27, the book of Acts. It says, "But not long after there arose against the tempest wind, called your Clidon. And when the ship was caught and could not bear up the wind, we let her drive. And the running under a certain island, which is called Claudia," he said, "we had much work to come by the boat, which when we had taken up, they used helps, undergirding the ship, for fear lest they should fall into the quicksand. They struck sail, and so were driven. And we being exceedingly tossed with the tempest, and the next day lightened the ship. And the third day we cast out of our own hands the tackling of the ship. And when neither sun nor stars many days appeared, and no small tempest lay on us, all hope that we should be saved was then taken away." Let's pray this morning. God, we pray that you would just bless and move, and but we pray that you just continue to be in our midst. Lord, that you'd meet every need across the house. God, we know, and you know better than we, God, the needs that are in your house today, the needs of storms that have arose. God, the problems that we face, both here today and that we face tomorrow. We pray that you would use this word and that you would bless and you would meet our needs this morning. We love you and thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. And amen. You may be seated. I would like to preach, God being my helper, this morning on surviving the storm. Surviving the storm. We begin to read here, and the Bible tells us that Paul is being transported by the Romans, and how that they're transporting him. And now that they're transporting him and they're going on, I want you to notice, first of all, in verse 9, that Paul tells them, he admonishes unto them and tells them, "Boys, I don't think that we should take this trip. And I'm afraid that if we do take this trip, it's going to lead to much hurt and harm and damage. There's going to be a lot of problems that go on. There are some things that come in life that we'll never ask for. There are things and there are storms in life that will befall you that you never begged for. You never did anything to it. You've lived a good life. You've lived a godly life. You've lived in the sight and the fear of God all of your life. And still yet, trouble can befall you. But a lot of times, amen. Let me preach there for just a minute. But a lot of times, listen, it's because we were warned and we ignored the warning. When the warning was given, we ignored the warning. Here, first of all, we find that the boat is out there, and the Bible says that they leave in verse 9, that he tells them, he said, that we shouldn't really go right now. It's dangerous to sail. In verse 10, he says unto them, "I perceive that this voyage will be with hurt and much damage." In verse 11, he says, "Nevertheless, the centurion believed the master and the owner of the ship, and those things which were spoken by Paul." Verse 12, he said, "And because the haven was not commodious to winter in." You know what he was saying? It wasn't comfortable. It wasn't roomy, and it wasn't large enough for their liking. Listen, when a pastor or preacher or a man of God begins to tell you the word of God and how that it will change you, it is a cry of warning, because God is not willing that we should die, but that he sent his son to die for us, that he might take away our sins, that He would become the propitiation of your and my sins. It's a warning. Listen, that man had failed in the garden and in the Adam, and Adam and Eve had failed God, and sin came into the world. But by one man that sin had came in, that one man came and died on the cross for the sins of you and I. It's more of a warning, telling us of the things. They sang the song just a little bit ago, holy, 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 and his train filled the temple. Did you catch that? It comes out of Isaiah chapter 6, and he said, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. It was his presence, church, and when he came in, Isaiah received that vision, and he said, God, after that he seen it, he said, I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in a people of unclean lips. Oh, but he said, there's flew a seraphim, and he grabbed the tongs, and he grabbed a live coal from off thine altar, and he did behold and touched my lips. He said, and behold, and then he goes on to say, God, how long shall I go, and how long will I tell the people about you? And God answered back in verse number 10 unto him. He said, make it. He said, make the hearts of the people fat. Make their ears heavy and their eyes shut, lest they see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their hearts and be converted and be healed. Then said I, he said, how long? And he answered and said, until it be a wasted without inhabitants. Listen, until there be houses without men, until it be utterly, utterly destroyed. What was he saying? He's saying, you give the warning and you give the call until there's nothing left. Paul stood up and said, if you would listen to me, we've got to stay here, because if we take off, listen, we're going to fail. Let me preach one thing to you this morning. Listen, you'll never weather the storm unless you do it by the word of God. You'll not go against God. You'll not go against his word and be blessed. But if you would admonish and lift up and live to his word, he will go with you through all things. He'll never leave you nor forsake you. He'll be there in the worst of storms. But if we don't listen to what God is saying, we'll never survive in the storm. The worst thing that could happen to somebody is that they get out on a body of water or on a river and they lose control of their ship. Now here's a group of men. They did not heed to the warning that was given. They ignored the warning. But we also see then the winds arose. Honey, you can mark it down. You can take a picture. You can put it in bold letters. You can do whatever you got to remember that you live in a world of trouble. Trouble's going to come. What are you saying, preacher? I'm saying not only was there a warning that was ignored, that the winds arose. Listen, winds will arise in life. Things will happen that you did not plan on. Things will happen that you did not count on. Things will happen when you do not expect it. What was the man, and who was the man that cried out one day and said, when it rains, it... Who said that? Somebody somewhere who realized that when it rains, it does rain. That when trouble comes, it comes. But there was one who was before whoever said that. I don't know who it was. But before that, Job said, man that is but born of woman is but few days and full of trouble. You know what that means? Winds are going to come. You're not going to beg for them. You're not going to ask for them. Sometimes winds just befall upon us. And it wasn't the water, don't get me wrong, that they were on. It was the winds that were going with them. Oh God, the Bible said, and Job cried out in 5 and 7, yet man that is born into trouble, and then as sparks he flieth upward. Listen, we live in a world of trouble. Trouble will fall upon us. So we find, first of all, that the warning is ignored. We find that the winds will raise. And then we find here in verse 14 that they have set sail. They have gone out. Now that they have gone out, the winds have raised. The Bible gives it a name. Today we would call that a hurricane. And now that is going on in verse 15, it says, when the ship was caught, we could not bear the wind, and we let her drive. You know what that means? They threw their hands up in the wheel. Jesus, take the wheel. We got no hope. We don't know which way we're going. We don't know which way we're coming. We don't know which way's up. We don't know which way's down. We do not know what to do. And you know what? They continued doing the same thing. Amen. Now listen to what the Bible said in verse 16. The Bible says in verse 16 that they run upon a certain island which is called Claudia, and which had much work to come to the boat. The boat needed repair. They needed to work on it. They needed to fix it. Verse 17, which they had taken up and they used the helps and the undergirding of the ship. And listen, they were doing this to try to make the ship steady and strong enough to bear the journey that was ahead of them. Now you listen to me for just a second. Listen, not only do we need to know the warning that was ignored, that the winds were rose, but that wasted efforts will get us nowhere. You can work as hard as you want to, you'll not make heaven. You can sing as loud as you want to, you'll not make heaven. You can preach as many sermons as you want, and heaven will not be your home. You can get baptized in every water hole around this country, and heaven still won't. You can sign your name on the membership books, and you can give money to every organization. But listen to me, unless you get your efforts out of the way and give yourself to God, listen, you will die lost without the Lord. That's popular preaching. Amen. The Bible said in Ephesians chapter number 2 and verse number 8, it said, for by grace are you saved through faith. Listen, it's not of works, at least any man should boast. Why did he say that? Because here are a group of men. Listen, it's not a small group, it's a large group on a boat that have set sail. They're trying to survive in a storm, and they're doing everything earthly possible for them to do it. The Bible goes on to say after that they've set sail again. They've got off of the sand. They're afraid that the quicksand would come. They've shoved off. They've raised their sail. They're back out into the water, getting beat to death again. And verse number 18, it said, and exceedingly they were tossed to and fro. Listen, they still haven't seen daylight. It's day 3. And verse 19, it says, they cast out with their own hands the tackling of the ship. You know what they were doing? Everything they could to survive in the storm. Hallelujah. Everything they could do, everything they could put their hands to, they were hoping that somebody would raise their hand and say, my name's Jonas, just throw me over, it'll go away. But it didn't. Guys, the storms of our life will never, ever cease. But by throwing away everything in our life, they still won't cease. Everything that you can do, everything that we can put our hand to, still will not stop the storms of life. They still not will hold to the enemy. But listen, as they go on in verse 20, it says, and neither the sun nor the stars appeared, many days appeared. He said, and no small tempest lay on us. All hope was gone that we should be saved. It was taken away. And then finally, Paul stands up. Paul stands up and he says, I know a way that we can survive. Now listen, I don't care who you are. I don't care how pretty you are, how ugly you are, how much money you've got or how much money you don't have. When you're on a boat and everybody's going down, when somebody stands up and speaks up, listen, you're going to hear what they've got to say. And the Bible says Paul stands up. He said, listen, I told you before we set sail, I've sat here quietly, I've sat here peacefully while you threw everything we needed and could have used off the sides. I've sat here quietly while the winds beat us half to death and while we traveled around the islands and trying to save ourselves in this ship. I've sat here, he said, but this time hearken unto me. He said, now listen, in verse 22, he said, and now I exhort you. He said, I'm encouraging you to be of good cheer, for there is no loss of man, any man's life among you, but of the ship. The ship ain't going to make break it. Now you mark this down, underline it if you want to. When you disobey God, go against Him, there will be a penalty for our life. Now listen to me. There's a lot of things that happen when our prior lives, when happens in our prior lives before we get saved, is underneath the blood. Don't shout me down. Amen. And because of that, sometimes we're going to bring something with us that ought not have been. But it's the cost of what we lived. It's the cost of what we've done before things. You let her drive. And it goes on to say, for there stood by me this night an angel of God, whose I am and who I serve. And he goes on to say in verse 25, wherefore, sirs, be of good cheer, for I believe God that it is even as he told me. You know how Paul stands up and he tells them, there is a way to survive in the storm. You've ignored the call. You've ignored the warning. Listen, you've done what you want to. You've gone through and the winds arose. You've done everything of your effects. You've done everything that your hands could do. But now, this time, would you listen to me for just a minute? Listen, we go in life, and I told you as I started, sometimes we ask for the storm, whether we know it or not, and sometimes the storm just comes. We took a vacation a few years ago, and we had to leave course. We were on a cruise ship. Off in the distance, you could see great big black clouds. You could see the rain falling over the Caribbean Sea, and as we were out there, the boat started to turn away from our destination. The captain of the boat was doing his very best to steer us around that thing. He knew the size of it. I didn't. He knew how large the storm was. All I could do was see what was before me. Hallelujah. He knew what was approaching, and the captain of the ship began to steer us around the side and deter us. Listen, that was about 3:00 in the afternoon. There the sun is brighter than ever. It will scorch your skin. The heat that rolls off of it is only tamed by the wind there. And as we are sailing around it, still yet later that night, me and Jess went to go get dinner, and I remember sitting down in the back of the ship to eat our dinner, and I remember our plates shifting and our little cup sliding on the back of that great big ship, because all that he did the best to get around the storm, and he did not go through the center of it, but still yet we found ourselves with everything that we could do stuck in the middle of that storm. Preacher, what are you saying? I'm saying you might have done your very best to steer around the storm, but storms still come. You might have seen it. You might have called it out. You might have heard before it was approaching. The Bible said in Psalms 107 and verse 23, it said, they that go down to the sea and the ships do the business of great waters. It said, these seas the work of the Lord and the wonders of his death. It says, for he had commanded it, he has commanded and raised up the stormy wind, which lifted up the waves thereof. They mount up today, he said, toward the heaven, and they go down again unto the depths. Their soul is melted because of the trouble. Let me get something straight for you today. Our heart does not melt within us because of the water. Hallelujah. It's because of what the wind is doing to the water. If I take a big gallon of water and put her in a pool and put you down inside it, it doesn't scare you at all. But dump more gallons into it and spill it over a hillside, and when it builds speed and it builds tenacity and it builds force and inertia, then at that point does it become scary. There's not a one of us that are scared of the ocean when it lays flat, but when the winds get it and it raves up inside of us. See, a lot of times we think that when someone has cancer, oh, that's a terrible storm. The truth of the matter is, it is for the one going through it. But a lot of times we live our life unaffected affected by it. But then when the waves hit us, we feel like giving up. Let me preach to you just for a second. Listen, it ought not to be that way. The Bible said that we're to bear one another's burdens. Oh, we're to carry those things upon us. That means when one of us hurts, all of us should bear that burden, and it'll take the load up off of us. Listen, what he's saying is there is a way to survive in the storm. That way is not alone. Hallelujah. I'm glad he didn't save us and just set us apart alone that we could try to figure things out. He said, I would go with you all the way to the end of the world when the waves rise up against us. And listen, when the enemy comes in like a flood, he said, I will raise a standard against them. Listen, Jesus Christ is that standard this morning. He goes on to say, they cry unto the Lord in their trouble, and they bringeth them out of distress. He maketh the storm a calm, and that the waves are still thereof. It's not the water that makes us afraid. It's when they rage. It wasn't the water that made Peter fail. It was the winds and the waves. It was when things began to be out of control. How many of us would say, don't raise your hand, say in your heart, a little sin's okay, preacher. Oh man, I feel it right there. I'm just dabbling in it. It's just social. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Just a little storm. It's just enough that you're comfortable. You know what I'm scared of? Water. When it's moving fast. When I was a little boy, we had when I was a teenager, we had a great big pond. My parents still do at the back of their property, and they had a 36-inch tube that goes to the overflow dam. We would get down inside that tube. I can't remember, 120 feet long or something down through the ground that shoots out onto the other side. It's a great big tube. We get down in that tube to the first rib. I think there are 40 feet sections down inside there where the ribs come together. We went down there and broke off the screws that hold the thing together so they didn't get you. Now listen, I'm not lying to you. Yeah, after the first person was the toughest person because they cleaned out all the cobwebs. And the next two people, and it was fun, they're on after. We'd get down where the first ribs come together, and then right then and there, you'd kind of chalk up the water, let it build up in the tube. Hey, listen, I grew up on a water park. And then once you got enough of that, you'd turn it loose. It would shove you outside that tube, and there's a big hole at the bottom where it ate out the water. We'd flop in there, go back up on the wall, come back down the tube. We'd do that for hours. It was fun. Listen, I'm not scared of water, but I am scared when someone says, hey, you want to go whitewater rafting? I know what that entails. I know what that means. And when you get there, they say, hey, here's a waiver. Make sure you ain't getting in the boat till you sign this waiver. You don't know why? You know why? The surviving of the storm does not mean, it does not mean that we're afraid of the water. It means we're afraid of the wind. They sang a song when I was a boy. I remember the day. Oh, the Perrys would sing that song often. I remember the day that the Lord saved me. Oh, heaven came down. I was happy and free. I shall never forget the day that the Lord saved me. I'm telling you, one of the greatest and the scariest things that will ever happen in your life is that you find yourself in the midst of a storm, because you'll realize where your help comes from. You'll realize it doesn't come from your hands. You'll realize that there might have been warnings that you did or did not see. You'll realize all these things. But I'm telling you, but when you get in the midst of the storm, the Bible said after that he addresses that, listen, that Paul cries out, he says, you haven't eaten for days. days. I'm telling you, in the midst of the storm, hallelujah, that even God can feed you when you're weary, when you're weak, when you've been in the storm, when you've been through times of drought, when you've been through times you thought you'd die and you'd never make it out, when you hadn't seen the sunshine in days, amen, and there was no hope for you, that you can stand back and say, I've been through the storm, and the next time the storm cloud raises, you say, I know where my help comes from. Listen, I believe that Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego, when they went into the fiery furnace, honey, they were never afraid of a fire again. They said, we've been there with God. We've been there before, and we'll get through it again. Listen, you can go through the storms of life, and God will shield you through it all. He'll feed you. He'll help you even when you're weary. The Bible goes on to say, in the end, there's 200 and some people, 276, if I remember right, on the boat. In the end, they crash. They crash the front of the boat upon the beach, and the back begins to get beaten by the wind and the waves, and the boat goes into pieces. And the Romans there are saying, leave the prisoners behind. But a centurion came, and he unlocks Paul, and he unlocks the rest of them. And he tells them, he saves them that day. Matter of fact, if you read with me there, verse, I believe it is, 43, he said, but the centurion, we know that that is a Roman soldier who oversees 100 people, okay? There's 100 centurions per legion in the Roman army. This man oversees, out of the 200 and some people on this boat, 100 of them are likely Roman soldiers. And as we see here, he says, willing to save Paul and kept them for the purpose. One last thing this morning, only do we know that even in the storm that we can survive it, even though that we heeded not the warning and that the winds arose and we have wasted time, that there's a way to survive, that God will help us when we're weary, but we find that there's a will to be saved. There was no hope for any of the prisoners had not the centurion came and unlocked them and led them off the ship. God does not show up in our lives. You're not here by chance. You're not here by circumstance. You're here by God's authority and His divine intervention. And the Bible said that there the centurion was willing to save Paul. I want you to know this morning that God is willing to save you. In spite of where you've been, in spite of the heeds or the warnings you have or have not listened to, the Bible said in Ezekiel 33 and 11, saying to them, as I live it, saith the Lord God, I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but that the wicked turn from his way and live. Turn ye from the evil ways, and why will you die, O house of Israel? God does not want to see people perish and go to hell. He said in 2 Peter 3 and 9 that the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. God does not want you to perish. As we stand across the building, you say, preacher, you don't know how terrible a thing I'm going through. One last thought and we'll get out of the way. A little girl by the name of Betsy and her sister, Cora. They were from Holland. While they were there, they owned a watch company, them and their parents, and the Germans invaded them. The Germans invaded them. They thought it was right that God's people have a hiding spot. They took God's people, hid them in the basement. The Germans found them. They took the girls and transported them off to a concentration camp. One of the roughest concentration camps, by the name of, if I can remember correctly, Ravensbrück. They sent them off to that concentration camp, and they put them in one of the largest rooms there with hundreds of other girls inside this concentration camp. And while they were there for just a few hours, one of the sisters screamed and she said, something pinched me. She hit her head on the bed that was above her because they were stacked in numerous numbers up to the ceiling. She climbed down out of the bed and her sister jumped up and she said, it's a flea. And there was more and more and more. Listen, the stench and the aroma that was inside of that camp. And the girl began to cry, and she said, but remember what we read this morning. She said in Thessalonians to rejoice in all things. You remember when we read that this morning? It was the third time through the New Testament. She said, yeah, but how can you rejoice in something like this? She said, I don't know, but we can try. And it goes on to say in Thessalonians, for this is the will of God concerning your life. And she said, well, think of it this way. And they begin to look around and say, what can we praise God for? What can we rejoice about? And the one sister, Cora, she said, there's nothing that we can rejoice about here. Betsy said, well, I'm here. You've got me. And she looked down at Cora. She said, and you've got the Bible. As the fleas are covering their legs and the odor, stench inside there, and the biggest storm that these young girls would ever face in their life. And she began to look around, and she said, I don't know what in the world we can do. She said, listen, we're just going to pray that God would show us. Betsy began to pray. She began to pray, and Betsy said this. She said this. Thank God for the fleas. Thank God for the fleas. And here's why. Because later on they would learn. They would learn later on that even though that all those things happened, the guards never came in. People wouldn't come into their tent. The girls were never abused. They were never taken advantage of because all the German guards knew that it was infested in fleas. Sometimes the storms of our life, sometimes the greatest problems that we face are God's miracle protecting us. In the meantime, while they begin to sing, come here. This morning, your lost need to be saved. Come on. You say, preacher, I made everything right with God, but you've not made a public profession. You need to. You need to let the world, and you need to let everyone know. Say, preacher, I'm going through the awfulest storm. I have no idea how God can fix it. I don't know how He can work it out. Listen, that's not your business. You need to get inside. come and ask Him into your heart and say, God, I'm ready for You to take care of this storm. I'm ready for You to move on it. Come this morning. Come. You're still doing it on your own.
Come
on. You do this morning, just slip your hand up with mine and say, Pastor, preacher, pray for me. I need God to move on my storm. Do that this morning. While we tarry just a moment, preacher, pray for me. I'm going through a terrible storm. I've done all that I can do. I need God to answer in some way. Do that this morning. God bless that hand. hand. That one. Those. Hey, the storm is real. It does real damage. Church, God bless you. We pray that those storms, that you answer that call and that you give that over to God. Give me just a minute. We're going to run to the back. Jacob and his parents, or his mom, and if his grandparents want to come or usher up here, we're going to get ready for this battle.